Y'all are doing good. It's been a little while since I've seen you. A lot of people not here, so hope they're ready for Thursday or they trickle in a little bit late. Some things I wanted to kind of bring up and make sure we're all on the same page. As I mentioned before, we kind of broke off that I would be updating all the grades on Canvas. Have all of you kind of seen that in Canvas? Every grade that you guys have, or every assignment that you guys have submitted that is accounted for with the grade should be there. I put your presentation grades in there last night. So everybody seen that? So again, like I said in the announcement in past class, if you have missed an assignment and it's excused, you need, well, I will already know it's excused. So I'll work something out with you to ensure that, you know, you get full credit. If it's not excused, I will still grant you partial credit because I do think the content we go over is beneficial for you. So I think it would be worth your time to go through it and complete the activity. So you are eligible to receive partial credit even if you've missed an assignment and you turn it in late. So you just need to communicate and let me know that. So any questions on grades or assignments? Again, if you're missing an assignment, make sure you look at the corresponding lecture that you've missed to know what's going on. Take your time and do that, and there should be no confusion in completing the assignment, okay? So the next thing I want to mention is that we obviously take our exam on Thursday. I did try to go in there and clean up the dates, because I know you guys have been kind of bringing that to me. I tried to clean up the dates for quizzes and assignments. I think
it's... It says the exam is next Tuesday. Yeah. Because I thought it was next Tuesday.
That's
not. Really? When did you check that? I changed it last night, but it was like really, really late last night.
Okay, then I wasn't late. Yeah, you were like 2 or 3 when you changed it. Mine says Thursday.
Mine says Thursday.
Okay, then it was.
Okay, sorry, I have late night, y'all.
It's also in the syllabus.
Yes, all the dates are in syllabus, but I did kind of hear your feedback on how much you guys use the Canvas calendar. I had no idea. I have never had a class say that they relied so heavily on it. So I just kind of went to the syllabus. And then also too, with us having so much with COVID in and out, assignments that typically didn't used to be, like the exams weren't on Canvas at all. So we didn't really have that indicated on the Canvas calendar previously. So appreciate your patience working me, but all the quizzes up until the end of the semester, as well as the exam, should be correct as far as the date is showing. Now, assignments, those dates aren't going to be there because those are kind of just rolling throughout the semester. It's not something that's necessarily like that I put up beforehand to complete. So if you're in class, you'll know when those assignments are due. And if you're not in class and you miss, you'll know that assignment is late upon turning it in. So those things should be updated in the system. So as you know, we'll do our exam, and again, check the syllabus if you have any questions on a date. But we have our exam this Thursday, but next week we'll be moving into strengths. So remember, this book is what we're gonna be moving into. So you'll wanna read the first part. It's all on Canvas, and I'll make sure you know you guys have an announcement or reminder. But all this next week we'll jump into. Again, make sure you have your code. The book comes with a code in the back if you got a new book. If you didn't get a new book, you can buy the code straight from the Strengths website, and you can just buy a separate code. So if you have any questions, let me know, but you want to make sure that you get the reading done, and I'll give you the appropriate deadlines. You should see it on your syllabus for when your assessment is due with your results. Okay? Any questions about that? Okay, I want to reiterate, too, because I've had some people ask me about the extra credit opportunities. Remember, they're in the discussion board. So the extra credit for Drift and Clarity, that ends, it's pretty soon, I think, the closing of that. Well, I said March 1st, but I gave you guys some more time. So I would just say before, probably class on Tuesday, if you want to participate in that, because we'll be done with this unit with Drift and Clarity. So if you guys want to get in and engage in the discussion, you can do that. Also, the Temple Grandin event, I know there was kind of like some things that were closed and you couldn't get in and register. Some of you obviously have been there because I see there's a discussion there, but also I think, well, I know they recorded it. So if they distribute that, then you have the opportunity to watch that back and then do that extra credit assignment. So any questions on that? Okay, remember I just put that up sporadically. It's just up to you to take advantage of it. It's totally optional. The last bit I wanna mention before we jump into today's content is the Do Good Challenge, the food drive that we talked about. So I did add that because we kind of talked before we left that we would start collecting this week. So what I thought, instead of just doing it the 1 week, because I know exams is going on and everything, we could stretch it out into next Thursday would be the last day we collect. I have some bins set up on the fourth floor of Ag Hall on the AECL wing, which in this discussion thing, you'll see kind of where they are where they're located. But those are there for drop off. So you can bring them to class if you'd like, or you can drop them off in Ag Hall. We've already had some people in that wing. I have a message going out to kind of let those faculty members know if they'd like to donate. So we already got some donations, which is good, because I had the bin set up last Thursday. So I just wanted to remind you guys, I know you guys said you wanted to do this. So definitely bring some goods if you would like. If you don't want to bring goods, but you still want to take part in this project, it would just require, I guess, your time and volunteering. These are some of the tasks that I would like to kind of designate to the group. So counting the cans and the donations each week, just so we can kind of measure our impact and see what we're actually doing with this project. So anybody who wants to do that, and we will just do it once a week. You'll count it kind of on that Thursday. And then dropping off the cans or the donations at the Stillwater location, you know, our daily bread, and then dropping off at Selfless Hands Foundation, the blessing box, on that Friday. If no one, I know I did have one student who said that she was open to donating in Oklahoma City because she goes. So that's kind of why I threw that out there. I will check with her and see if she's open to it. If not, I live in Edmond, so I don't mind dropping it off. But if one of you want to be there, obviously the president and CEO of the organization would love to kind of meet anybody from the class. They're super excited about having these donations. So anybody who wants to do that. Also, so if there are cans that are coming to class that are a little bit more than maybe Aaron or I can carry, I'd like to have someone help us carry those over to Ag Hall right after class. So that would be really great for a volunteer to take over that. And then also, I thought it would be nice if we each wrote a small appreciation note to our daily bread as well as Selfless Hands, just to tell them we appreciate what they're doing in the community, trying to kind of fill a major need with food insecurity issues. So, and that note literally can be like how you guys wrote to the health centers. Just, you know, we appreciate your work. Hope you enjoy our donation. Thank you. And that's all. So what I said is that if you're interested in something in particular, just comment, you know, make a reply, and then we'll know who's divvied up for this round. So we will likely do another donation round in April. Not sure if we'll do the clothes or just food drive, but nonetheless, we'll kind of maybe divvy up some new volunteers for the next one unless the same ones want to stay on. So are there any questions about this, the food drive? Are you guys still kind of on board with wanting to do that? Okay, great. So feel free to, like I said, bring something on Thursday or bring it the bins like on here. I mentioned that there's one right outside the copy room right by like Dr. Ramsey's office. And then there's one right outside of the elevator right between Shelley and Chelsea's office. And then there's one right kind of across from 439 and right kind of by my office as well as another TA office. So those are kind of the locations of the bins if you want to just kind of bring it when you're at Ag Hall. So I definitely would like whoever wants to count though to be maybe signed up by, I would say, by probably Wednesday, just because we're going to count Thursday and there are some things to count even though, you know, we kind of just discussed it today. Okay, any questions? Okay, perfect. So want to jump into kind of a little bit of what we'll be talking about today. So I do want to do kind of a brief review. You guys should have watched the lecture from last Tuesday's class. And I just kind of want to go over some of those key points because, again, we're preparing for the exam. But if you've watched that lecture and looked at those PowerPoints, that's what I'll be pulling up today. You will be fine with the content as well as obviously reading the chapter. So what I want you guys to do is maybe if you can pull up digitally or if you have it printed off, it doesn't matter. As long as it was submitted on Canvas, your Katie Davis worksheet, because we are going to kind of go over that today. And then I have a few questions that I want us to kind of answer on a sheet of paper. And I'll give you a few minutes to kind of answer this question. You can pull your book out, do whatever you need to do. So as kind of our quick review, I want us to know values. What's the definition? What did the power, or what did the present, what did we talk about during the lecture of what values are? Then also, motivation. Motivation. What were those five motivators that we talked about in chapter four that leaders have that kind of pushes them to lead? And then, it was five of those. And then six benefits. Of having clarity of your values. Okay, so on first step is to take a sheet of paper out, and I want you to answer these three questions. Again, these were during the lecture from last Tuesday on the PowerPoints as well as in the chapter. So I want you to write what are values? What is the definition that we discussed on what values are? Then the five areas of motivation for leaders. Write a brief kind of description or explanation for what those five motivators are. And then the six benefits of having clarity of values. Writing those six benefits and a little bit of a description of what those six benefits are. So we're going to do that first as a quick review, just to make sure that we got all the content from that chapter, the key points, and then we'll go over Katie Davis, because obviously that worksheet applied these concepts, okay? So I'm going to give you guys probably about 5 to 7-ish, 10 minutes to kind of complete this. And then we'll discuss it as a class. And probably as I give you time to work on it, I'll have somebody come up and write the answers on that board, just so we can all see them. Anybody want to go write the first one up there? Values, what are values? Anybody that's kind of finished or close to being finished? Okay, go ahead. If you write it up there, then we'll let you kind of talk about it as we go through. Anybody want to do the second one? At least maybe three of them, or yes, you want to go? Go ahead, Effie. Who wants to do the other three? Wants to do six benefits of clarity of values, three of them. Okay, who wants to do the other three? Yes, that's fine. Yes. Who wants to do the other three benefits of having clarity of your values? Because whatever three he does, you'll have the other three. So who wants to volunteer to write those up there and talk a little bit about them? Nobody's feeling the pressure, I'll start calling people. I would rather you guys volunteer. Okay. Clayton, you wanna do the other three? Thank you.
Do we have the other two motivators yet?
No.
I'll do this.
Perfect. Y'all. some of you guys still working a little bit? Okay, I'll give you guys about another minute or two. I'll give you guys about one more minute. Okay, let's talk a little bit about these. I'm probably going to pull up the PowerPoint too, kind of as we go, just in case it's kind of far to see some of that. Okay, first, chapter 4. What was a little bit about chapter 4 about? What was the overall topic of chapter 4? Some big takeaways you took.
Personal values and leadership values into a wide concerning skill.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, values. Exactly. And kind of when you're trying to get your values, you're also looking at your vision and wanting to have alignment between your vision and values. Typically, just because of the class scheduling and days off and things, we typically do an additional activity with that newspaper, which you maybe think I may have clipped that part out of the lecture, but typically we go around the class and look at those newspapers that you did, and then we use the, and you guys, I'll pass out the value sheet. I'll pass out when we do Katie Davis, but you guys should have seen it during the lecture when it was discussed. I put the handout on that module from last week. But we typically, you would pick out your core values, what you feel are true to you, but then we would let students go around the class and look at your newspaper and see if they would associate the values that you personally selected with what they saw with your vision, with your newspaper activity. So the end goal, again, is that you're wanting congruency and what your vision is, your personal vision, which includes, you know, your leadership vision, you're wanting to make sure what people see with that vision is in alignment what your true values are. So let's go over values. What are values? What do we have up there on the board? Are you going to read it? Sorry. Sorry.
Standards are principles that guide your beliefs, decisions, and actions.
Standards are principles that guide your beliefs, behaviors, and actions, and your decisions. So just thinking about what are those internal things that are most important to you that guide you when you're trying to decide something or whatever your beliefs are. Okay? Again, just wanting to be aware of the motivations and the values that you have. That's another thing that can get you to that place of clarity. Remember, clarity is the end goal. That's where we want to be at. So if you are in drift, also having a good understanding of your motivations and values is very important. So now let's go quickly through the 6 benefits of having clarity of your values. Okay, so the first 3, go ahead, read those. And as you kind of read through guides behavior, maybe just say a little bit of what that means, guides behavior, and go through. I can't remember who wrote the first 3. We can go from left to right. So the ones on the left and then move to the right.
So clarity of your values, know if you're acting in your values. So
say that one more time, sorry.
Clarity of your values helps you know when you act incongruently with your values.
Okay, exactly.
Basically, like, you say something that you said you thought was wrong or something like that, those feelings, but you kind of realign with the values and just get yourself back on track with, again, how you should be acting when it comes to your values. The second one being clarity of values will help you know if your values really match the organization's values. So, I mean, it's basically saying you can love the job and everything, but if you don't, your values don't line with what the company wants to get done, you know, probably don't need to be there because somewhere down the line you'll probably not be happy because, you know, someone might do something you don't like.
Absolutely.
And then the last one, I had a bit of trouble understanding what it's trying to say, but clarity of values helped in encounter conflicts among values. So I guess from reading that, to me it seems like knowing your own values, when something comes up, maybe I don't know, when you're challenged or you're experiencing drift, you might stray away from your values. And having clarity of your own values will be on you when you do things that feeling drift.
Yes, exactly. Having clarity in your own, because it's inevitable to face conflict. Whether you have conflict within your organization or in a situation where your values may be challenged in a sense. So having clarity of what your personal values are helps you when you engage or encounter that conflict. So again, kind of like I said at the beginning of class, you know, when we're looking at diversity of opinions or cultures or all these things, a big thing is that, you know, everybody's values are shaped by their experiences, their family, their personal culture. So being able to appreciate and respect another culture doesn't mean you totally get rid of your own personal or core values. I don't think that that's necessarily the goal. The goal is to get to a place where you can respect other people's values, but still maybe, and if you see a shift or something that maybe becomes a little bit more important, I don't think that that's necessarily a terrible thing. But I don't think when we're looking at kind of what those values are, those kind of deep philosophies that you have when we talk about core values in the chapter, those deep-rooted things, sometimes those aren't something that you necessarily budge on, right? They're something that's kind of foundational to you. So when you're looking at those value systems, kind of keep that in mind when we look at other people who have different values. It's probably deep-rooted and kind of inner core to who they are. So you just want to get to a place of respect and appreciation for those differences, okay? So, okay, for the other 3, let's go through those of the 6 benefits of clarity, of having clarity of your values.
It guides your leadership behavior.
Okay.
But without, without like proper behavior, like it's, people are like, it's like a leader's not calm, cool, collected, and they're like acts appropriately towards people. They're not going to get anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
It guides your leadership choice. And obviously they're making the right choices. If your values don't align with the choices you make, then you and yourself are like not like strong. Like you and yourself are not strong than the people who follow you, are gonna respect you, or like if you can't make the right choices when it comes to leading, then how are people gonna follow you? It speeds up the decision making because right answers are more readily apparent. I think that goes along with the choices that you make too, and behavior. And you know what's good and what's bad, and you'll be able to more see that more clearly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's almost as if when you're kind of on the edge of something, you're not really sure the right decision, but you kind of go with that gut feeling and that feeling of kind of like, this is kind of where I naturally fall. That is where you're really intentional with those core values or your values in making those either decisions when you maybe aren't so sure. So again, these went over detail the last lecture. If you haven't watched it, I encourage you to watch it because you will see this material on the exam. So wanted to go through those six benefits of having clarity of values. So the last bit that I want to cover for review is the five sources of leadership motivation. So let's just do the same thing, go through the first three and then the second two to kind of say what they are and describe them a little bit.
Okay, so the first one is validation, and that normally comes in like some form of like verbal confirmation from someone that like you have the ability to lead and you're doing a good job. Rewards is kind of like those extra things that come with being in a leadership mm-hmm. position, like prestige, money, power, mm-hmm. all that kind of stuff. And then impact is just knowing that you're making a difference and like doing something, impacting someone else's life with your leadership role.
Absolutely. Perfect. Okay, the last two, service and meaning.
The way I view service is for some leaders, the reason they lead is for others. And so like, for example, like if you wanna like help like little kids, you find any opportunity you can to go be a leader in that mm-hmm. aspect. Or if you wanna be a teacher someday, you find aspects to kind of volunteer your time and just to help others learn and motivate them. And then for meaning, I feel like meaning is kind of hard to describe for some people because it's the way you view it, and so it kind of embodies all of them. And so like it's kind of like the way I view it is like it's asking you like, which one of these motivations do you have? Like, are you looking for a spot to try to give back to others, or are you looking for validation, or are you looking to make an impact? That's just kind of the way I look at it.
Yeah, I think kind of just that kind of giving meaning to your life too, like building on that of just kind of when people say it's bigger than me, it's bigger than myself of whatever it is I'm trying to do, kind of a little bit of what Katie Davis was talking about. And on that worksheet too with Katie Davis, it's not necessarily a right or wrong answer on what you maybe saw some of her motivators, but it's just as long as you can kind of articulate as to why that would be a motivator for her. So definitely just when you're thinking about the five sources of leadership motivation, remember the motivation is the thing that pushes you into leadership. It's the thing that encourages you, gives you enthusiasm when you move into a leadership role. So these are some of the five areas of where you may be getting your motivation from. Okay, any questions on that? Okay, again, make sure that you've reviewed all this. Again, this is obviously on these PowerPoints that are up there. It's not a lot of detail in the PowerPoint, but it's in your book as well as in the lecture from last week. So I just wanted to kind of cover that and make sure, but just because I'm not sure how many people were able to watch that lecture, I think we're going to break off in groups for the Katie Davis review because we're going to talk through that worksheet, and I don't want to be the only one up here talking about it, okay? So I want you guys to kind of talk about these. I'm just break you off in kind of little pods like normal, but I want you guys to talk through these questions on the Katie Davis worksheet. I'll pull it up on the projector. And I'm also going to hand out, here, I'll give you this while I pull this up. I'm also going to hand out the value sheet, just in case someone, you know, you submitted it on Canvas, but you don't have any way to pull up what you did. Just want to kind of give you a reference point there. Okay, so for this worksheet, obviously you guys should have already submitted it to Canvas, so it should be pretty well stained on your brain at this point because it's really fresh. But I want us to, open up discussion with who was Katie Davis? What did she accomplish? You know, what did you guys learn about her either in your personal research or what you learned about her from that YouTube video that we had on Canvas? Then I want us to look at kind of the things that you've talked about in these questions. So remember personal vision and leadership vision, what those two things are. So we want to see what do we think Katie's personal vision was based off of what you learned about her. And then what do you think her leadership vision was? And I think it was really clear in that YouTube video of kind of where she stood on those areas. And then also talking about the five core values, that sheet there. What were her five core values that you think really kind of demonstrated what was important to her? And then what is Katie's motivation to lead? Again, we just went over the five motivators. So what do you think was her primary motivation to lead based off of what you learned about her? And then describe an example of congruence between one of Katie's core values and her behavior and or a statement decision that she made. Again, referencing back to the YouTube video and what you may have done. We're going over this in class because she is going to be on the exam Thursday. So I did, even though it was something that we did last week, I just want to make sure I reiterate these points so you're prepared. And then after this, we will do a brief review with the study guide. Okay? So how about I kind of have you guys here break in a circle, talk about this part of the worksheet. You guys kind of break in a circle. Stop, you hear it loud. You guys break in a circle, and then you guys break in a circle. Again, I want you guys to be able to tell me who Katie Davis was, what did she accomplish, really briefly, her personal vision and her leadership vision. When I ask that question too, I want you to guys kind of refresh, what is a personal vision? What is a leadership vision? Because there is a bit of a difference in that area, remember? Again, what are her motivators? Of the five that we just talked about, what were Katie's motivators? And then describing the area of congruency. Remember, congruency is where you have that perfect alignment. They overlap. You're walking the walk and talking the talk. So with her values and her behavior, where did you see congruency? And her values and what she said, she did. Where did you see that congruency? Congruency is a really important thing in this class. That's where you want to get to where everything is overlapped and you're kind of in your stride. Okay? So talk through these, and then as a class, we'll kind of break out and talk a little bit about her, and then we'll have kind of our first couple leaders done for the exam. Okay? I'll give you guys probably about 5 minutes. It shouldn't take that long because you guys should be familiar.
I look rough when I took stats. I look like a hermit.
I feel like I'm last night.
find out.
I don't know, and I had to just go to bed. Like,
I know that
like,
when she was 18, she went on
to serve
and
then
got it like 6 hours.
Yeah. So I'm like, sometimes I feel I'm not done with my project. Like, I have to have it done by tomorrow. But it's like our first kind of, which we might be on the Sunday. So that was our biggest. And then our project, I'm not in the first 3 days. So
good.
I'm not saying
at least we get it over.
That's true too. So I have to submit it by tomorrow.
Yeah.
So I was trying to get a head start on it now. So luckily, I got all my data collected.
That's good.
Yeah, it worked out that, you know, I put it in Facebook groups and it was like Facebook on purpose. It was like, it was the size of your household, that the amount of hours that each week. So I just, it is just kind of crap. I don't know where we are at. So I just put in the doctoral group and I'm like, they understand.
Yeah,
I wrote up for this math. So I mean, within like a day,
yeah,
I had like almost 100 responses.
Oh my god!
Yeah, I was surprised. So I was like, okay, this is great. So now I have plenty of data. I don't think I'm gonna use all of it, but I just have to
like analyze it.
I
feel like a haircut or like just going and getting your hair done is so refreshing. I'm getting my hair done on Thursday and I'm like really excited. I'm just like, okay, I need help.
I know, it's like a nice self-care kind of thing to do, you know? It's if you don't think about it.
And then
like,
but
like, you appreciate it. Just do all the work and then I can do work in between. Like, it's not like that when I'm doing my hair, it's like full afternoon.
Yeah.
That's what I'm doing.
Yeah,
I'm glad you
didn't
go
like,
camper yourself.
I know.
Everything that
and the thing is, I always take my bag,
like
oh, I'm going to be so,
like was
effective, or, like, so efficient, or whatever,
like,
and then I end up just chatting with my hairdresser the whole time, but honestly, I feel so much better after, so it's fine.
Therapists, almost, like, mini therapists, like, they're just, they do chat, because, like, I did, the only time I didn't chat with her is when she was talking to someone else in the chair, and I was under the dryer. But other than that, I did talk to her, like, the whole time, and you talk to other people in there, too, and it's just like, okay.
This is refreshing.
I know, it was nice. I was like, how do I bring my gun? But she won't tape. Like,
I don't think there's,
when she has a tangle in her hair, it's just, it's kind of difficult to get past.
So, I was like, this is a kid. I have little orphan Annie hair. Like, my hair's naturally,
like,
I can get it straight, like, because I can't handle it.
The longer it is, the harder it is.
When I was younger, I don't know what it is about people with curly hair, but they have like the most sensitive scalps for some reason, which like stinks because like they have the tangliest hair.
Yes.
So I have like a really like coarse curly hair texture. I could not handle it growing up.
Oh, well, yeah, then you can.
Yeah.
My daughter's
It shrinks so much.
It's like up to here.
Oh, I just had my hair grow down until I was like in middle school.
Yeah.
And I never cut it. It was just curl up.
Yeah,
so it looks really short.
It's like the shrinkage because I'm like, it's down to her.
Oh, I can find a picture of myself. I had really curled. Like, I literally, everyone was like, oh, you look like I was a redhead too. So they're like, oh, you're a little orphan Annie. And I was like, I hate it.
Hey,
multiple choice.
This is part of it. He got with the program. Okay, y'all. Let's take a few moments to talk a little bit. We're going to just breeze through this. We're not going to spend a lot of time. But let's go through this, and we'll kind of go from group to group like normal. So number one, personal vision and leadership. So before we talk about Katie's, what is a personal vision? It can be anybody on this. What's a personal vision?
It's how you want to lead your life.
Mm-hmm.
Set like an example for others through it.
Yeah, like maybe your personal goals, the roles you have in your life. Just kind of that plan you have, that roadmap for what you have. So what about leadership vision? Remember, leadership vision is part of your personal vision. What is leadership vision?
Your leadership vision is what you want to do within your career or the things that you're working towards, not so much your personal life.
Absolutely. Like your just specific professional and leadership role goals, or just kind of what is important in that professional realm. Okay, so now we think about Katie Davis. First, who was Katie Davis? What did she accomplish?
She started the Project Unigo to help the children in need when she went on a mission trip when she her senior year.
Right.
And then instead of going, when she decided to stay going to college, she would move back to help all the children.
Right. So what she initially thought would be a year of just kind of serving a community in Uganda, what do you remember that monumental thing that happened that influenced her to want to stick around?
Wasn't it the girl who felt the house fell down and her dad died and she took
care of
her sister?
Yep.
And so the little girl.
Yes. Yes. So taking care of the young lady that she found crushed by a house, and just felt really, once she took her to the hospital and realized there was no one to take care of her, she kind of felt like, why not me? Why don't I take care of her? And then when the little girl called her mommy, she was like, okay, this is what I'm supposed to do. I think I'm supposed to step in. But she couldn't adopt at that time, remember, because she wasn't old enough, but she's fostering to pursue the adoption. Do you guys remember how many girls she says she has?
14.
14. close. I mean, once you get to the teens, it's almost all the same. So yeah, 14.
Don't count off on my paper.
I don't know. I might need to. We'll see. That's a pretty important detail. I wonder. Multiple of you.
Maybe it was the one girl plus 13 others. That's probably why.
I don't know.
I heard 13.
Okay, the justification, I'll give you a pass on that. So with that being said, she also stepped out and helped other people too. Remember helping people who were sickly, the woman who had TB. So she stepped out and she, in her, faith really pushed her. So I won't go too deep into that. I'll let you guys talk a little bit about it. So what do you guys feel was her personal vision? And then let's talk about her leadership vision. So what was her personal vision? Okay, well, let's talk about both of them. You can go ahead and talk about both of them.
It seemed like it was all the same. It all came down to I watched multiple videos, just short little videos, and every video and every interview, it was the same thing. It was just to help people.
Mm-hmm.
One thing she said was, if there's a need, the first thing she does is figure out what the need is. If she can fulfill that need, and if she can, what's the point in not?
Absolutely.
That was a big thing that I took away from what she said is basically just, it was basically just, if there's a need she can help, then why not help?
Mm-hmm. Right. So that was important to her, to want to help others, like you said. Help others and fill that role. As far as on personal vision, what drove that kind of desire for her to help people? Yes, her faith. You want to elaborate at all on that?
Can I go to number four?
Hold on, I'll wait on that.
She just kept saying quotes about God said to her, blah blah blah. She would just always listen to him. I just got her faith. She was always talking about it.
Right. So her personal vision was in alignment with her Christian beliefs. So just what she believed a Christian should do as far as service and actually helping people, that was really just kind of her personal vision. So now when we saw that overlap with her leadership vision is when she started her organization. Now her professional vision to serve others turned into an organization that served, young children who needed community, who needed family, who needed support. So that, and then even the book she's written, again, this is more of her leadership vision and just wanting to push that message, encourage others to give back and serve. Okay, does that make sense? Where we kind of see a difference with the personal and then how she used her personal to kind of drive her leadership vision. That makes sense? Okay, let's move to number two. List and describe what you believe to be Katie's five core values. Explain what led you to your decision. So anybody want to share the top five? I'll go right up here.
So I put community, integrity, friendship, help others, spirituality. It's pretty clear that she has a servant's heart and just wants to do what's best for everyone. Whether that means, putting yourself first or putting yourself last. And that kind of goes back through with integrity, just doing what's right. Community, obviously, she's doing amazing things for the community and helping as many as she can. That kind of goes with the friendship, too, building that relationship with everybody, building that trust, and making sure what needs to be done is done.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Anything similar, different?
Mine was pretty much, I had faith, family, compassion, joy, and resilience. They're a little different than, the ones on the paper, but, it's pretty much the same. If she had community, the community was her family. Mm-hmm. So, compassion, obviously she has an amazing amount of compassion.
For sure.
It changed her whole life and moved her beyond this. Joy, her whole thing was, making people happy and helping others. And their resilience, obviously, we saw, all the good things, but we didn't see the sick people, we just saw, the afterwards of not helping them. We didn't see what she went through or what they went through, but in the bad times.
For sure. Definitely, just her heart to serve others. Anybody, I'm sure probably most of us agree that faith or spirituality or something would have been certainly one of her core values. That was pretty obvious through getting to know her. So we'll see that even with Dan West, think back to him, we probably see faith and spirituality as a big part of who he was and driving him to want to give back. He talked a lot about his Christian beliefs. So you'll see those things that kind of in leaders that maybe are just kind of clear for people, which is a really good thing, because we saw in both Dan West and Katie Davis that their actions seem to align with those values pretty well. Okay? So the next one, what is Katie's motivation to lead? Out of the five motivators, what is Katie's primary motivator?
I know I put the service one. Mm-hmm. I think we can all agree that she didn't care about any of the rewards or anything. She just cared about serving others and her impact on them. So really the impact and service is what I put.
Absolutely. Everybody pretty much agree with that? Anything different burning inside that you want to share? But yeah, service and impact. You look at the first half of that video, it's pretty clear that was what she was about. It, like you said, it wasn't about just recognition or any of those things. She hasn't even come back to the States very much from what she said. So it's really important her doing the work and actually creating impact. So the last question, describe an example of congruence between one of Katie's core values and her behavior and or a statement decision made. I know, Braylon, you kind of touched on that a little bit.
I think on this one, something that just popped out to me was the spirituality, and I think spirituality is one of her core values, and I don't think there's any other way around that. And I also think that it's so congruent together, and just hearing the way she spoke, hearing how she leads and lives her life through God and following his plan, I don't think there's any other way to not see the congruency between those two, and then not see how similar those two are together. And I just think that for her, without God, there is absolutely nothing. Mm-hmm. And I think that she truly sticks to the value of that.
Absolutely. Definitely. Her spirituality and how she spoke, what she did, the mission of her organizations, certainly congruent. Anything else anyone wants to share on that? overall, the example that Katie Davis gives us as a leader is just someone who is in complete congruence from what we can tell. Her vision, what we would probably perceive to be her personal vision and her leadership vision, would you say that it seems to be congruent with the values that we just talked about? Would you think there's some congruency there, maybe with the motivators? So again, you know, when we're thinking about kind of values and all these kind of concepts that we're going over, remember the end goal is congruency. You want to be the kind of leader that, like, if we saw a 30-minute video of you talking about yourself and what you're trying to do, would it be easy for a group of people like you to watch it and say, oh man, I can kind of see what their values are, or I can see based off of what they've done or what they're passionate about, that's what their values are, this is what their vision is. So again, like I said it before in the beginning of the semester, there's questions in this book, and if you're really kind of intentional about wanting to develop in your leadership or wanting to develop in particular areas, which I know is a goal for you, whether it's you in the classroom, in your professional setting, whatever, take advantage of those questions as you read their chapter. Just maybe ponder them for a minute and move on. I know you guys have things to do outside of, you know, this class, but just in your leadership development, you may want to take some time to think about those questions. Any additional questions about Katie Davis before we do our quick review? Okay. Again, if you haven't already, make sure that that's uploaded to Canvas, your assignment on that. And now we'll just kind of review for the exam. Yes, before you leave today, just bring those up. Holly, for those questions that you write, I'll give you some extra credit points that you did today. So make sure that you have answered the questions and you write your name on the paper. Mm-hmm. And if you're watching this lecture, you can submit it too.
Do you need this back?
No, that's just for you. Okay. And that lets me know who's watching the lectures or not too. So, let me pull up the exam study guide on here. You know, I don't think I've actually uploaded it to Canvas yet, so.
Will the exam be like multiple choice, or do we need to have like what we told?
Yeah, so the way the exam is set up is half the points you get for your exam is multiple choice, and then the other half is essay. So, kind of I'll go through this. You'll want to study these areas, whether it's the lectures that we've had, whether it's the PowerPoints, the chapter, course assignments, those things. Everything's free game. But it will be multiple choice and essay format. Okay, so for chapter one, we want to talk about leadership. If you think way back to kind of when we talk about the definition of leadership, kind of maybe a little bit about what the study of leadership, when we talk maybe like born versus learned, just be familiar. You don't have to be super in detail with that, but just kind of have that in your mind. You may see that. Then drift and clarity. We spent a lot of time on drift and clarity. I've tried to reference back to it in class a whole lot. So obviously you want to know about drift and clarity in some detail. You want to know what drift is, what are some of those causes of drift. You want to be able to identify them. So again, when you are listing these out on essay form, one, you want to be able to recognize them if you saw them in on any of these, if you see it in multiple choice, but you want to be able to name them, okay? Name them kind of what it says in the text, because I can kind of tell when you're kind of guessing, but I want you to use the right vocabulary. So for drift and clarity, you want to know what are some of those causes of drift that we specifically named from the chapter. What are some of the primary causes of drift? I'm saying a lot because it's going to be on there. It's important. And then clarity. What is the place of clarity? What is clarity? Then again, the top characteristics of a leader. Remember when we did that trait auction? Remember the top characteristics way back when that we went over? You want to know those, and you want to know what the top one is. maybe after that you don't have to particularly know the order, but you want to know at least what they were and which one was the top one. Then again, the leadership framework. I can show you that really quick. It's that framework. It was at the end of the PowerPoint from last week's lecture. Let me show you guys that really quick.
On the characteristics of a leader, do you want us to know like what the class thought or like what you told us, like the honest?
Just the one we listed from the research. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you won't have to know that particularly from class what we voted on. Just what kind of the final answer was. So this leadership framework that will pop up. Now, you're not going to have to know this leadership framework and have to fill in each area, each component of it. I want to make sure that's right. Okay. You're not going to have to fill in each area of that, but you should know what makes up the leadership framework. You should at least know the titles of those areas if you were to have to kind of know what elements make up the leadership framework. Okay?
So like the leadership profile, leadership value.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Just know all those areas.
The arrows as well, like just the interior.
Just know the whole thing.
Okay.
Yeah, just know the whole thing, but you don't have to know where everything goes. Okay. Just be familiar enough with it to where if you saw it, you'd know that that is a component. Okay? So then the 9 perspectives of leadership and the 9 costs of leadership. Remember we spent some time on that. Y'all did that worksheet when you interviewed people on campus or whatever to kind of learn a little bit more about what they said they viewed as a leader. And then you guys conceptualized their responses and decided what you thought their perspective of leadership was or what their cost of leadership was. So you want to make sure that you can name those 9 and explain them in your own words. Okay, and again, I'm looking for some pretty close titles for each of these. You know, I can give you a pass if you're a little bit off, but if you just, there's no words at all in what you're naming that reference what you're describing, yeah, I may know what you mean, but I really need you to kind of know those titles. So definitely know those and be able to describe them. So that's all from chapter 1. Any questions on that? Okay, chapter 2. So this big part is going to be based off the presentations. So the organizations and organizational life are changing. So if you missed the presentation, you want to be sure to watch it because it is based off of what the groups presented and what you presented. It's not based off of necessarily what you see in the chapter. You want to be able to give examples from what you heard in the presentations. So make sure that you watch those presentations if you weren't there or that you refresh your notes that you were taking during those presentations. So that's the primary bit for chapter 2. Any questions? Okay, chapter 3, your leadership vision. So again, personal and leadership vision. We just talked about that. We talked about that with Dan West. Want to make sure that you understand what a personal and a leadership vision are. Then the 8 strategies for discovering your leadership vision. We talked about 8 strategies that you can utilize to discover that vision. And then the 6 benefits of clarity of vision. That little bit we talked about again with Dan West, you want to be sure that you can name and list those too. Any questions with that? Dan West, you'll want to be able to describe who he was and be able to kind of like with the worksheets. So while we kind of went through the Katie Davis and went through the Dan West, you will kind of simulate that same experience on the exam. You should be able to understand Dan West and be able to apply some of these concepts when you describe him. And then chapter 4, leadership, motivation, and values. So again, those leadership motivators, and then I think I put 4 there, but that should be 5. So if you want to change that to 5 leadership motivators, values and motivation, kind of what, like we talk about, what is values? What role does motivation play in your pursuit of leadership? Remember, it's that enthusiasm, that thing that kind of pushes you to want to be a leader. Then Katie Davis, again, knowing, you know, who Katie Davis is, what has she accomplished? And then being able to articulate concepts from what we've went over in class to her. So again, it may be something that is directly Dan West. It talks about leadership vision, but it may be that we talk about Dan West, but we're talking about motivation and values. So you want to be able to be familiar enough with them to where you can apply these different concepts to them. And then common values, kind of some of the values that we talked about, core values, all that different language that describes values. Are there any questions? Okay, again, like I said, it's multiple choice, but then on the essay pieces, you'll see the point breakdown when you get the exam, but you want to make sure that you're using the right vocabulary from the book and from the presentations and all of those things. I'd even encourage you in some of those presentations, particularly in the beginning, that talks about authentic leadership. I think it was from either the first or second module. Hint, hint, you want to know that equation, okay? You want to know that equation that talks about authentic leadership. Not the one that was just put in chapter 4, not that one. That's a different one that we're not going to focus on for this exam. But one of the earlier ones that we've seen in either module 1 or 2 that gives you an equation for how to get to a place of authentic leadership, you want to know that for the exam. And it's on the PowerPoint. It's not necessarily something you'll see in the book, but it's in one of the PowerPoints. Be here for your exam. Be ready to go on Thursday. If you are not here, you receive a 0. Especially if it's not excused and I don't know what's going on, you receive a 0. But the bright side is if you do receive a 0, is that you can drop an exam, but you'll just have to take the final. But hope to see you on Thursday. Any questions? Okay, remember, bring up those answers to those questions we did. Bring them up to the front so I can give you some credit for today. Y'all have a good day.